Hello, Mr. True. Okay, let's finish part two of this solving equations with logarithms. It's the fall and near Halloween, so hence the shirt. Pumpkin pie, my favorite dessert. Okay, so we need to solve this trinomial, solve it for x, and it looks quite a bit different than what maybe we're used to. So let me tie this in with an equation that maybe you are more comfortable with, and that's simply x squared plus x minus 6. Now, if I gave you this equation to solve, I highly doubt that anybody would have a problem with it. When you factor a trinomial, in this case a quadratic, you look for factors of the last term that go in the last two blanks, factors of the first term that go in the first two blanks, and we're looking for factors of 1, and so there's no choice there, it's 1 and 1. And because the leading coefficient is 1, we're simply going to look for factors of 6 that subtract to be negative 1. And that is going to be, let's see here in blue, negative 3 and positive 2. They multiply to give me negative 6, and they also add up to the middle term, which is negative 1. Now, normally when we have quadratics, we just kind of write x and x without really thinking about it. But why is it x and not x squared? Well, because we want to multiply this binomial back together, we're doing x times x is x squared. So a number times itself is equal to x squared. Well, when you take a number and you break it down into something times something equals that original number, that's a square root. The square root of 16 is 4. Why? Because 4 times 4 is 16. So indeed, when you just simply write x and x without thinking from x squared, you are doing the square root of x squared. Now let's review fractional exponents for a minute. Fractional exponents are when you have a power over a root. So if you're doing a square root, that can be written as a fraction of a power of 1/2. And so we have x squared in the middle, and around it being applied a square root or a power of 1/2, and when you have stacked exponents, you are multiplying. So 1/2 of 2 is equal to 1. So when you take the square root as far as exponents are concerned, that's the same as dividing the exponents by 2 or multiplying those exponents by 1/2. So when you have a trinomial, it is going to be factorable as long as it's factorable in the first place. And as far as the exponents are concerned, you want those exponents to count down in halves. Whatever this first exponent is, then half of that, because that's what you do when you square root in exponents, and then just a constant at the end. So if this were, say, a 4, well, then the middle term would have to have an exponent of 2. And x squared minus x, or excuse me, x to the 4th minus x squared minus 6 equals 0 would factor down to the square root of x to the 4th would be x squared. So, just remember, with your square root symbol written as a fractional exponent, that is a power of 1/2. So as far as exponents are concerned, you're dividing them by 2. So in this harder looking example, we have an exponent of 4x. Well, as long as the middle exponent is half of the first exponent, this will be a factorable, or could be, a factorable trinomial. It will be factorable as long as you can get your leading coefficient and your constant to come together to give you that middle term of positive 1, and I'm not sure why I changed the sign on that one, but let's factor this over here. So we have a leading coefficient of 1, we have a constant of 6, so we're going to look for factors of 6 that subtract to be positive 1, not like my negative 1 here in this example I made up. So we're going to be looking for e. Now, if you're going to square root e to the 4x, that's 4x divided by 2, so it's going to be e to the 2x plus 3 times e to the 2x minus 2. And then after you factor, you set each factor equal to 0 to finish the problem up. So we're going to say that we have e to the 2x plus 3 equals 0, and e to the 2x minus 2 equals 0. And now we're going to try and solve each of these for x. So we're going to subtract both sides by 3. on this original question and add 2 to both sides here. And when you have a variable in the exponent that you're trying to solve for, a lot of times it will not come, that variable will not come out of the exponent without using logarithms. Excuse me. But before I even bother with this one, you're never going to get a positive base. Remember, e is 2.718, da 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 da. It's kind of like pi. It's a decimal that runs on forever. Shows up a lot in nature problems, electrical engineering. It's continuous compound growth. At any rate, you're never going to get a positive base to any power give you a negative number. So this one's going to be undefined and have no solution. Now over here, we have e to the 2x equals positive 2. We're going to apply the natural log function to both sides to get rid of the base of e and allow us to get the variable down out of the exponent. So we're going to have natural log of e to the 2x equals natural log of 2. And if the natural log and the e did not cancel out, we would pull the 2x out front as a leading coefficient and then divide both sides by the natural log of e. But when you log a number that has the same base as your logarithm, they will cancel out, giving us 2x equals the natural log of 2, and then we'll divide both sides by 2 to finish solving this problem and get x is equal to either the natural log of 2, that is not going to be 2 divided by 2 is 1. It is not the natural log of 1. The natural log of 2 divided by 2 is going to be, if I'm reading my workout right, positive 0.347, if you get that typed into your calculator correctly. Okay, let's move on to the next one. Log base 3 of x minus 1 equals 3. Now, if you have a log function in your equation, the first thing you're going to want to do is isolate that log function, and mine already is. So, and this is a pretty straightforward question. I can actually go right into exponential form by going by remembering that out of a logarithm you get an exponent. Remember, the log of 100 is equal to 2 because 10 squared equals 100. You always get exponents from log functions. So because this is a very basic function or equation, I can just write 3 to the third power equals x minus 1. But for teaching purposes, and not all equations come out that easily, I want to remind you to get rid of log functions, you do the exponential function. Again, let's think about it. A log of 100 equals 2. So I logged 100 and I got an answer of 2. If I'd like to get back to 100, I do 10 squared equals 100. That exponential function will undo the log. They're inverse functions. So I'm going to make both sides of my equation an exponent of 3. And when you have a base of 3 and a log base with that same value of 3 in this case, those are inverse functions and they will cancel out, allowing the exponent to just simply drop, or the x minus 1 to simply drop down. And we get x minus 1 equals 3 to the third. That's x minus 1 equals 3 to the third is 27. And then add both sides by 1, and you get a final answer of 28. And if you want to make sure that that works, simply go back and plug it into your original question. And my original video, this is actually my second take, my original video was only seen by about 22 people, because then I realized when you have a math function in your original equation that can become undefined, like you can't divide by 0, so if x is in the denominator, you can't square root a negative number, and here we have x inside of a log function, you cannot log a negative number, you cannot square root a negative number, you cannot divide by a negative number. So when you're working with an equation that has some major restrictions on the domain, you had better plug that back into the original problem and make sure that your answer doesn't make the original equation undefined. I forgot that step and therefore I messed up on my last two questions or my last two examples in my video, so here I am doing my second tape on Halloween. So plug that in, 28 minus 1 is 27, and you can log a positive 27. Okay, I try not to make mistakes in these videos, but every once in a while when I try and talk and write at the same time, that happens. So if you ever notice a mistake in my videos, please remind me and I'll send me a notice and I'll I'll correct it, or in this case, reshoot that video. So one of my students actually found a mistake, so I thought, hey, not only did he watch my videos, but you know, he knew enough to find a mistake in my work, so I gave a bonus point for that. Here we go, natural log of the square root of x plus 1 equals 5. Now, again, I just said, if you have a log function in your equation and you'd like to get rid of it, exponentials function will undo a log function, their inverse. So I want to get rid of this natural log. It's already isolated. And natural log is log base e. So if I'd like to undo that log base of e, I'm going to make both sides an exponent of e. And that is going to cancel out the log function and give me x plus 1. Now it's the square root of x plus 1, but I'm going to do just for teaching purposes, and it's usually a good idea. The more into advanced math you get, the more you want to get comfortable with fractional exponents. They're much nicer to deal with than radical notation. So my square root I'm writing as a power of 1 over 2, power over root. It was the second root, second square root. And that's equal to e to the fifth. Now, if you have a fractional exponent, you are going to raise both sides of your equation by the reciprocal of that power. So if I have an expression raised to the 1/2 and I want to get rid of that power of 1 over 2, I'm going to raise both sides by the reciprocal of 1 over 2, which is simply 2. And you probably would have done that anyway had you left the radical in your equation, the undo a square root by squaring both sides. So 2 times 1/2 is 1. Excuse me, I'm still getting over a cold. Which is x plus 1 equals, this again is power to power, so that's e to the 10th, and now we're going to get the plus 1 away from the x by subtracting, and we get x equals e to the 10th minus 1. If you put that in your calculator, the answer to this question, it seems like it's unbelievable, it's so large, is 22,025.5. That's rounded off a little bit, of course, but that is the approximate answer. This is the exact form of the answer of this equation. And again, if you want to check it, and you do need to, because our variable is in a log function, you cannot log a negative number. So make sure you plug that back in and that it works. Okay, moving on to the next example. We have log base 3 of x minus 5 plus log base 3 of x plus 3 equals 2. I'm going to combine these two functions. I got 2 minutes left, and that's going to give me log base 3 of x squared times minus 2x minus 15 equals 2. If I apply a power of 3 to both sides, I'm going to get x squared minus 2x minus 15 equals 9. Subtract both sides by 9, I get x squared minus 2x minus 24 equals 0. That's factorable. I'm going to get x minus 6 times x plus 4 equals 0. And my solutions are x equals 6 and x equals negative 4. Now, if I plug these back into the original problems, negative 4 minus 5 and negative 4 plus 3, those are both negatives. And again, you cannot log a negative number. So the only answer is 6. I'm Mr. True. I'm out. I appreciate you guys watching. Thank you for choosing my videos. Thank you for letting me help you guys out. Woo! Bam! Go do your homework.